Hi, everyone. My name is Lorraine, and I'm a product manager at the Azure Storage team. And today, I will be walking you through how to get started with Azure Container Storage. So for our video today, we will start with an overview of the service. Then we will talk about the benefits that it has. Then we'll jump to a demo on how to get started with it and how to run MySQL with Azure Container Storage. When running stateful workloads in containers, managing storage can be challenging. And in addition to that, cost savings is always top of mind. So we end up finding ourselves in a balancing act, trying to get the performance that a workload needs without wanting to compromise on cost. And this is where Azure Container Storage fits into the picture. Azure Container Storage is a fully managed software-defined storage solution built for and tightly integrated with Kubernetes. This means that you can do everything in the Kubernetes control plane, just like you would do today if you are leveraging any other storage CSI drivers, like the disk driver, for example. Because of the way Azure Container Storage is set up, we are able to deliver on price performance needs. And we'll dive more into the architecture that the diagram on the right is alluding to in a few moments. But the main call out here is that Azure Container Storage lets you leverage different backing storage options depending on what your workload needs are. In the current container space, most users are using storage options on cloud platforms that are traditionally built for VM-centric architectures and then retrofitted to container. This makes the overall user experience convoluted and less than ideal. With Azure Container Storage, you're able to overcome a VM-native environment. Three main benefits that Azure Container Storage brings, along with this shift towards a container-centric storage solution, are the following. The first one is that Azure Container Storage lets you pack multiple volumes in a disk. So before, or with the disk CSI driver, if you're familiar with that, each time you create a persistent volume, that maps one-to-one to an Azure disk. Now you can have multiple persistent volumes from one Azure disk, meaning you can get more for what you pay for. The second benefit is flexibility in design. So Azure Container Storage has increased limit of persistent volumes or PBs per node. And the last benefit is that Azure Container Storage can provision volumes on local storage in your cluster. So you can take advantage of your local storage options on your cluster and the performance that those options deliver. Azure Container Storage introduces the concept of container storage pools, where a pool is a grouping of storage resources that are presented as a single entity for your AKS cluster. Existing Azure storage offerings like ephemeral disks, Azure disks, and Azure Elasticsearch can all serve as resources backing a storage pool. You can create a persistent volume in this storage pool and mount it to your pods to store data that your application needs. Now, diving a little more into each of the benefits, for the first one, you can see here, before, every time that you provision a persistent volume, you would need to provision an Azure disk that would then correspond to that PB. In the normal workflow, you most likely had to end up over-provisioning on the capacity in order to achieve the high performance levels that you need, leaving lots of unused storage that you end up having to pay for. Now, with Azure Container Storage, you can do key things like provision a single disk that fits your workload's key performance requirements, share that performance across your multiple persistent volumes while only paying for a single disk. Traditional VM-centric storage had limits on the number of disks that you can attach to a VM based on the SKU tops. So this basically translates to how many persistent volumes you can attach to one of your cluster nodes. Most likely, you had to end up upgrading your VM to a higher SKU, which means that was more expensive in order to get more PBs per node. Now with Azure Container Storage, and because we are able to pack multiple PBs into one disk, you can attach up to 75 persistent volumes per cluster node without needing to go to the highest VM SKUs. Now for the third benefit, when you choose the ephemeral storage option, you can use either your temp SSD or local NVMe drives in your VM SKUs as storage. Azure Container Storage is able to orchestrate persistent volumes on those drives, and that provides the benefit of having sub-millisecond latency, which is great for workloads where performance is a concern. Rather than having to hop through additional networking to communicate with a remote disk or a storage option, we use NVMe over Fabric connection to the local disk to achieve the highest performance possible. Typically, local storage, for its ephemeral nature, was best for workloads that needed a fast local cache or that were very sensitive to performance, but that offered application-level replication support. One of these examples is Cassandra, for example. Azure Container Storage now offers local NVMe replication for applications that require the performance characteristics of local disk, but still need added resiliency. So you can configure replication in your storage pool definition, and this will synchronously replicate data volumes across the NVMe disks in the storage pool based on the number of replicas specified. Now we're going to jump onto how to get started with Azure Container Storage. So as a Kubernetes user, if you are looking to run and deploy applications and you are looking to scale out these applications, you are probably playing either of two roles. You can either be an operator or a developer. If you're an operator, you're deploying and managing the cluster and the storage environment. And if you're a developer, you're running and deploying your applications. So what Azure Container Storage has done, it has simplified the experience for the operator while maintaining the same experience for the developer. The first step is to enable Azure Container Storage, and you have two options to do so. You can first enable it on a new AKS cluster by running acaks create, and you're gonna specify certain values for your AKS cluster, and then you're also gonna provide the enable Azure Container Storage flag. And you'll need to specify a storage type. So it can be Azure Disks, Ephemeral Disks, or Azure Elastic SAN. You can also run this and enable Azure Container Storage in an existing AKS cluster with AZ AKS update. And in a similar way, you will pass the enable Azure Container Storage flag. What this will do is it will enable Azure Container Storage, but it will also create a default storage pool. So you can start creating persistent volumes on the go. And you can specify the storage pool capacity, the storage pool name, the storage pool SKU, and even the specific node pool where you want to enable Azure Container Storage. All of this information can be found in our documentation. This is a more specific example of what we'll be using in demo. So I am creating a new AKS cluster called ACS Demo Cluster in my ACS Demo resource group. The VM SKU I'm using for my cluster nodes is standard L8S V2, and I want my node pool to have three nodes. And I am enabling Azure Container Storage with Azure Disk, and I am not passing any specific custom values for the storage pool. So like we talked about earlier, you will have a default storage pool created when you enable Azure Container Storage. And on the left, you can see what the storage pool definition looks like. You can also create your own custom storage pools if you would like to do so. In our documentation, we have examples on how to do so and which parameters can you specify to customize the pool. But in this case, the example on the left is a premium LRS storage pool of size 1 terabyte. And then when you create a storage pool, or when we create one by default, when you enable the service, this will also automatically create a storage class. And you're probably familiar with storage classes if you are already leveraging any of our storage drivers. So this storage class is the one that you will be using for your application. So on the right, we have a stateful set example in which we have a volume claim template section. And in that volume claim template, we are specifying the storage class name. And that storage class name is the storage class that was created automatically as part of the storage pool. So you can either use the default storage pool that we create when you enable the service, or if you want to create your own custom one, you only have to create the storage pool that will automatically create the storage class, and then the developer can go ahead and use it. So we are going to start the demo by creating an AKS cluster using the command that we saw earlier. So in this case, our cluster is called ACS Demo Cluster, and we are in the ACS Demo resource group. We are using a standard L8S V2 SKU for our nodes. Our node pool will have three nodes, and we are passing the enable Azure Container Storage flag with the Azure disk value. So I'm going to go ahead and run this. And what this will do is this will create your AKS cluster, enable Azure Container Storage. And like we said earlier, it's also going to create a default storage pool of type disk. So once you have run that command, you'll have your AKS cluster created. In this case, mine has just been created. And if you go to the extensions and applications menu, you should be able to see that Azure Container Storage was installed. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to check for the storage pool. So we're going to do kubectl get st, and then we're going to check for the AC store namespace. And as you can see, we have an Azure disk storage pool that was created. You can also do kubectl describe st to look for more details of your storage pool. So in this case, my storage pool is, the SKU name is Premium LRS, and it's 512 gigs in capacity. So we can also check for the storage classes. And we have three new storage classes that were created. These two that are marked as internal, they're for internal use of the service. You should not be using them, but this one is the one that you should be using, AC Store Azure Disk with the Container Storage CSI provisioner. Now that we have enabled Azure Container Storage, or maybe your cluster operator has enabled it for you, I'll show you how easy it is to deploy a MySQL application deployment that uses Azure Container Storage. MySQL is an open source relational database management system. Now we are going to create a persistent volume claim to use with our MySQL application. This is what our persistent volume claim looks like. I'm calling it MySQL PVC. And for the storage class, I am using the storage class that was created for Azure Container Storage. So in this case, it's AC Store Azure Disk. And this PVC is of size 10 gigs. So now we are going to create our PVC. And it has now been created. So we can double check by running kubectl get PVC. You will notice that the status is pending. This is because the storage class was set to wait for first consumer as a volume binding mode. So we need to first have a deployment use it before the status can change to ready. So what I'm going to do now is I am going to create that MySQL deployment. So here we have an example of the MySQL deployment. As you can see, we have a service. We have also a deployment. I'm just calling it MySQL. And in volumes, we are specifying the persistent volume claim to use. So in this case, I want to use the MySQL PVC that we created earlier to have this application run. So once we save that, we can go ahead and create that deployment. And once that's been created, you can double check for the pods and see if they are running. And now you can see that we have one of our pods, MySQL, running. Now that we have our pod running, we can check again for our PVCs. And in this case, our PVC that was previously on a pending state, it's now bound and we have a persistent volume created for it. When we enabled Azure Container Storage at the cluster creation time, we specified that we wanted to use it with Azure Disk. But let's say that we want to enable a different storage type to use for a different workload. Maybe I now want to run a workload that needs the ephemeral disk performance. In this case, I can enable the ephemeral disk storage type by running an AZ AKS update. So in this case, I will run AZAKS update, provide my cluster values, and then I will provide the enable Azure Container Storage flag, specifying that I now want to run ephemeral disk. And specifically for ephemeral disk, since we have two options, NVMe and Tempest SSD, you can provide a storage pool option. So in this case, I want to run Azure Container Storage with ephemeral disk on my NVMe drives. If you remember earlier, we created our cluster nodes using a standard L VMs queue, and those VMs queues have NVMe drives, so I can leverage those with Azure Container Storage as well. So I'm going to run this command. And once this finishes running, you should be able to run Azure Container Storage, not only with Azure disks, like we are already doing in our MySQL workload, but you can also deploy new workloads using persistent volumes from ephemeral disk. Each of the different storage types that you can leverage with Azure Container Storage take up different resources in your cluster. When I say resources, I mean CPU and memory resources. So when you run this AZAKS update command to enable a new storage type, the resource consumption in your cluster will be updated depending on the storage type that you want to use. You can learn more about how many resources each storage type consumes in our documentation. You can also disable a storage type if you're not using it anymore, and that will liberate resources in your cluster as well. So now, after that additional storage type has been enabled, you can again check for your storage pools. And as you can see here, we have two storage pools. The first one was the Azure Disk storage pool that we enabled when we first installed Azure Container Storage. And that's the storage pool that we are using for our MySQL workload. But additionally, now we have an ephemeral disk NVMe storage pool that you can now start leveraging to create persistent volumes for a different workload. So as you can see, it is super easy to leverage Azure Container Storage. You just need your cluster operator to enable the service. And from there, everything is pretty much to how you would use the disk CSI driver. You will just leverage your storage classes to create persistent volume claims or persistent volumes and use those for your application. If you want to learn more about Azure Container Storage, here are some links to have you get started, both with a couple of blog posts that we published, as well as our documentation, if you want to learn more about the service. And if you have any questions, you can always reach out to my team at askcontainerstorage@microsoft.com.